Hello, my name is Rupinder Sial and welcome to Spartan Tutorials. So regulation of gene expression and the concept of DNA binding proteins has been instrumental to our understanding of biology in the last few decades. This brought a revolution in terms of our understanding of how cells which are pretty much same in terms of DNA content, for example, brain cells, kidney cells, heart cells in case of humans, they have almost the same amount of DNA, actually the same amount of DNA. But due to differential gene expression, that is which genes they turn on and which genes they turn off at a particular point of time, determines the identity of these cells as well as the functions that can be performed by these cells. So this was a huge realization and a lot of studies have been done in this area, and it is still a very active area of research. And today we are going to talk about a technique which has helped in determining what are the actual sequences bound by these proteins. So that technique is called DNA's one footprinting. It relies on the fact that the proteins, when bound to the DNA, they will protect it from enzymatic digestion by deoxyribonuclease 1, an enzyme which basically chews DNA or digests DNA. Okay, so let's get into it and let's find out what is it about. So there have been many examples of proteins which are bound to DNA, and this has led to the whole paradigm of lacoperon model, galactosoperon, and the idea of activators, repressors, you know, proteins doing histone modifications, nucleosome modifying enzymes, chromatin remodelers. All these proteins, they bind to DNA at some point of time. The nucleus is basically crowded with these proteins which are acting on it, you know, ripping it apart or opening it up for transcription or DNA replication at some point of time or another. And a lot of structural studies have been done on these proteins as well. As you can see in this example, we have the lambda repressor bound to the operator, and this was one of the paradigms of gene expression in the 1950s. Discovered by François Jacob and Jacques Monod and André Lvoff in the 1950s, you know, it really revolutionized that, okay, this was a new idea at that time. We have to realize that this idea that there are certain genes which make proteins which don't do anything. It is not a one gene, one enzyme hypothesis. It is a one gene, one polypeptide, and this polypeptide or protein could be involved in just regulating other genes. This was a huge conceptual breakthrough at that time. Okay, so you can see lambda repressor bound to the DNA here. You can see estrogen receptor, DNA binding domain, you know, bound to DNA. These are all structural studies. So we know from X-ray crystallography that they are actually there. They are, that's how they bind. And lots of DNA binding domains and motifs have been identified in these proteins. You have P53, you know, one of the rock stars of cancer biology. Its misregulation causes cancer, and here it is shown binding to DNA. So one of the techniques that has been important in characterizing this DNA binding to proteins has been DNA's one footprinting, especially the identification of exact DNA sequence bound by these proteins. And this has led to the whole genome-wide analyses too, okay, as we will see. So the first paper which reported DNA's footprinting was published in 1978. So right at the cusp of development of recombinant DNA technology and biotechnology, this was a very, you know, heady times. So David Gallas and Albert Schmitz in Switzerland, they developed this technique, and the idea is pretty simple, just like gel shift assay that we just discussed. So what we do is we take a DNA fragment of interest that we know binds a protein. Okay, we treat it with alkaline phosphatase, because the idea is we want to label it at one end, only the 5' end, by phosphate. Okay, so what we do is we remove the 5' phosphates first. These are usually the 5' phosphates. These are usually removed by alkaline phosphatase treatment, And then what we do is we use polynucleotide kinase, usually derived from FAJ-T4. This is available from multiple different sellers. For example, NEB, Invitrogen, they all sell this enzyme, T4 polynucleotide kinase. And this is used to add gamma P32 labeled ATP. And this adds A here, okay? So that's what it adds. And then what we can do is we can remove this, and only at the 5' ends we can have the single-stranded DNA, and we have only the 5' end labeled. This is extremely important for this technique to work. So we don't want both the strands labeled. Now we come to the actual experiment. We have on one hand DNase-1 cleavage of naked DNA. So we use a very dilute amount of DNase-1. So on average, it nicks a DNA fragment only once at one point. But on the whole, for the whole population of fragments, it will nick at different locations, at all the locations will be covered. And in the other controls that we have the protein. So the protein, what it will do, it will protect the fragment where it binds from DNase-1 cleavage. So we will see an absence of the fragments which correspond to the fragment where DNA binding protein binds, and it protects that fragment from cleavage. So we will notice some absent bands, and those are the bands which are those are the sequences which are bound by that protein. So we will run it on gel. This is a polyacrylamide gel, actually a sequencing gel, and we will also run the AT and GC reactions. So this could be Maxim-Gilbert sequencing or Sanger sequencing in the earlier days. Nowadays people use simple Sanger sequencing. We denature these fragments, okay? So we denature these fragments, and just like you can see here, only the 5' end is labeled, and we see this ladder appearing, and we have the footprint. So this footprint corresponds to the sequences which you can identify using the actual sequencing gel that you are running in parallel. What is the sequence that is bound by the protein? Here you can see another study where they were looking at the binding of three proteins, dorsal, twist, and snail. These are all DNA binding proteins. Dorsal and twist are activators, and snail is a repressor. These are involved in Drosophila dorsal ventral patterning. I think students of developmental biology must be familiar with this concept. So this is a fragment of a gene called rhomboid, especially a piece of enhancer which is bound by these proteins. And here you can see there is this sequencing run G plus A. You can see the first lane, it contains the sequencing run, and then you have the increasing amounts of dorsal, twist, and snail, and this has led to identification of the sequences bound by these proteins. So they have identified 4 dorsal sites, 2 twist sites, and 4 snail sites in this DNA. So you can see a lot of information can be gained by DNase-1 footprinting, especially the exact sequence bound by the protein. So this was my discussion of DNase-1 footprinting technique. Let me know in your comments what you thought about it. Have you used it in your experiments in the lab? If you have, please share your experiences. I have not done this experiment, but I have seen it being performed in the lab where I did my MSc internships. So let me know in the comments below whether you have seen this or whether you have used it, or if you have encountered questions related to it in some exams. Okay. As usual, do subscribe to my channel and give it a thumbs up if you like the video. Till the next time we meet, take care and bye-bye.